beautiful, what a beautiful song. And wow, what a beautiful job singing the song. But every time I hear that song, I think about the sister of Lazarus, not Martha, but Mary. And they had invited Jesus into their home. And many of you know the story that Martha was so busy wanting to make sure that everything was perfect, that the meal was perfect, the refreshments, that, you know, everything had been cleaned. In fact, she was so busy. But then we find Mary, and where is Mary? She's where we always see her. She is at the feet of Jesus. And Martha comes to Jesus and says, Jesus, don't you even care that my sister is not helping me do all of this work? And Jesus looked at her and said, honey, listen, she's doing the most important thing, sitting at my feet, listening to me, enjoying my presence. She knows she's not going to have me with her here always, and so she's taking advantage of these moments with me. I feel like we're sitting at his feet this morning, don't you? Aren't you thankful for everything that Jesus has done to make eternal life possible for every one of us? Everything that Jesus has done to make healing and freedom possible for every one of us in this room here today. I want you to take your communion elements, because it's in these elements that we're reminded of everything that Jesus did to give us eternal life, to make possible healing and deliverance from anything that holds us in captivity. If you don't have the elements, you can just raise your hand. Our ushers are ready to serve you this morning. I see some hands down here. We'll wait until everybody has been served before we share it together. What a precious moment this is. The more I seek you, the more I find you, the more I find you, the more I love you. Yes. I want to sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you and breathe, feel your heartbeat. This love is so deep, it's more than I can stand. I melt in your peace, it's overwhelming. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and if you'll take the bread in your hand, he took bread and he broke it, of course, which was symbolic that his body would be broken for you and me. And through his brokenness, you and I would be made whole. Through his brokenness, now you and I can bring our broken pieces, the mess that we've made of our life, we can put them in the hands of the master, and he can make a masterpiece out of those broken pieces. But it's only because of Jesus. So together, in remembrance of him and with thanks in our heart, let's take the bread together. Thank you, Jesus, that you were wounded for our transgressions. You were bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was on you, and by your stripes we are healed. Thank you, Jesus. And in the same way Jesus took the cup and he said to his disciples, this cup represents my blood. It's not like your blood, it's sinless. It's spotless. It has the power to remove all sin. And he looked at him and said, now take and drink this cup in remembrance of me. Let's take it together. Thank you, Jesus. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And what can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that washes white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Now would you just take a moment, lift up your hands and thank him for all that he's done for you and all that he still wants to do for you. All that he's made possible in your life and mine through his body and his blood. We thank you today, Jesus. And everybody said amen and amen. I want you to take your Bibles this morning and go with me to Exodus chapter 33. Exodus chapter 33. And while you're going to Exodus 33, I just want to remind you of a couple of really important events. You saw a lot of things on the video just a moment ago, and I don't mean to be repetitive and redundant. But on January the 26th, it's kind of a part of our As For Me and My House emphasis. On January the 26th, a Thursday at 12 p.m., our CareNet ministry has put together an estate planning event for those of you that can be here. Now, I know a lot of people don't like to plan out, you know, their estates because they're afraid that if I plan, it might come to pass sooner than I want it to. That's the reason why a lot of people never put together wills and things like that, because they're afraid if I do, I might die. But no, as a part of the Me and My House emphasis, let me tell you something. You need to make sure that things are taken care of for your families. Amen? And then on February the 5th, I want you to make sure that you've put this on your calendar. On that Sunday, we have a very special guest. Chris and Janet Goins are going to be with us. And that day, we're going to have an emphasis on marriage. But we want everybody, even if you're not married, you need to be here. Because your hope, I'm sure, is that at some point you will get married. And then that afternoon at 5 o'clock, we're going to have a marriage enrichment time together with Chris and Janet from 5 until about 8 that evening. It's just going to be a wonderful day for our marriages. So I want you to make sure you're planning to be with us. This morning, as a part of our series, As For Me and My House, here's what I want to talk to you today about. As for me and my house, we will seek the Lord. What does it mean to seek the Lord? To seek the Lord is to seek the presence of God. You'll notice that most every song that we've done here this morning, that the common thread through those songs is we were singing about the presence of God. But not only does it mean to seek the presence of God, it means to seek the face of God. Because to seek the face of God is to seek the presence of God. The Bible tells us so much about seeking God. In 1 Chronicles chapter 22, verse 19, David tells us that we are to devote our heart and soul to seeking the Lord your God. You see, seeking God means that we yearn for God, that we long for God. Like the psalmist said, as the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs for you, God. Maybe something missing in your life and you're seeking what it is that you're missing. And that's the way it should be with us. Every day of our lives, we should be seeking God, the presence of God, the face of God. The psalmist also tells us that we need to seek his face continually. Not just at certain seasons of our lives or at certain times of the year, but he said we need to seek the face of God continually. Daniel even tells us in Daniel chapter 9, verse 3, how he sought the Lord. He said, I sought the Lord through prayer and fasting. That's just a couple of the ways that we can seek God. And we are in a season right now at the beginning of this year of prayer and fasting. And we're not praying and fasting just so we can get God to do what we want him to do. No, we are praying and fasting because we're seeking his face. We desire more of him, more of his presence in our lives. We can seek him through the word of God. We can seek him through worship. There's a number of different ways that we can seek God, but the important thing is that we all are seeking him. Now, I've asked you to go to Exodus chapter 33 this morning because I believe it's one of the most powerful passages of Scripture as it relates to the necessity of God's presence in our lives and the necessity of God's presence in our marriages and the necessity of God's presence in our families and, yes, even the necessity of God's presence in our church. But before we look at Exodus chapter 33, let me give you a little bit of the backstory, going back to Exodus 31 and 32. God has brought the children of Israel out of Egypt through the Red Sea. They are now in the wilderness, and they come to a place called Mount Horeb or Mount Sinai. Moses leaves the people. He goes up on the mountain where he would be with God for 40 days. During those 40 days that Moses is on the mountain, he has quite a conversation with God. And God gives to Moses the law. God gives to Moses the Ten Commandments. Now, while Moses is up on the mountain with God, and understand, like I said, he's been there now for 40 days. And the people down at the foot of the mountain, they're getting a little bit antsy. And so they go to Aaron, who was Moses' brother, and they say to Aaron, we don't know what's happened to Moses. For all we know, he's gone up on that mountain and gotten crossways with God, and God has killed him. And so they ask Aaron, they said, we want you now to make us or to fashion us a God that will lead us from this point forward. Do you remember what Paul said in Galatians chapter 3, verse 3? He said to those Galatians, he said, how can you be so foolish? He said, this journey that you are on with the Lord, he said, you started this journey in the spirit. But he said, now you're trying to finish it in your flesh. And if we're not careful, that's what happens sometimes if we don't see God working quickly enough. Is we'll begin to take matters into our own hands, and whereas God has brought us to the point that we are today, if we don't feel like things are happening fast enough or quick enough in our lives, then we take matters into our own hands. That's foolish. And that's what the people of Israel did here. They took matters into their own hands. They said, Aaron, we want you to fashion us a God who can lead us from this point forward into our promised land. And so here's what Aaron said. Aaron said, okay, give me your gold earrings. And everybody, and it's a Hebrew word that says, they tore off their gold earrings. And they gave them to Aaron. And then Aaron melts that gold down. And he fashions and molds a golden calf out of that gold. And the people began to worship that calf. And about the time they began to worship that calf, guess what? Moses showed up. Boy, isn't God's timing something else? But Moses shows up. Now, he already knew what was going on because God told him when he was up on the top of the mountain. He said, those people, Moses, that you brought out of Egypt. God wouldn't even take responsibility for them. But he said, those people that you brought out of Egypt have corrupted themselves. And when Moses gets back down to the foot of the mountain, the tablets upon which the law was written, he takes those tablets and he breaks those tablets into pieces, symbolic that the people of God have already broken the commands of God to not put any gods before him and to not worship any graven images and other sins that they would commit in the process of all of that. Well, as a result, the judgment of God comes. 3,000 people die because of that sin. Moses then goes back up the mountain to intercede for the people of God and asks God to forgive the people. And listen to what Moses said. He said, and God, if you don't forgive them, then just blot me out of your book, because you're not the God that I thought you were. And it was only because of Moses' intercession for those people that God decided not to kill them all. And this is where we come to in the story in Exodus chapter 33. Because notice what it says. It says, then the Lord said to Moses, leave this place, that is Sinai, you and the people you brought up out of Egypt. Notice, you brought up out of Egypt. And go up to the land I promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying, I will give it to your descendants. Now notice what God says to Moses. He says to Moses, okay, Moses, everything's okay. Just go ahead. Just continue your journey. Go ahead and go on up to the land that I promised you. And then he goes on and he says, I will even send an angel before you. But not only will I send an angel before you, I will also drive out the Canaanites, the Amorites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, the Jebusites, all of those paganites. He said, I'm going to drive them out. And then he said this. He said, and go up to the land flowing with milk and honey. It sounds like everything's okay, doesn't it? But then notice what he says in the last part of verse 3 there. He said, but I will not go with you, because you're a stiff-necked people. You are stubborn. You're obstinate. You are disobedient. And if I hang out too close to you, I might destroy you on the way. Now, I've had the opportunity to travel quite a bit in my life. Not as much as I would like to, but still, I've been able to travel quite a bit. And you've heard people give a couple of different outlooks or point of views as it relates to traveling. Some people will tell you that it's not about the journey, it's about the destination. That whatever it is that you have to go through to get there, it's worth it just to get to the destination. And then there's others that would say, no, it's not about the destination, it's about the journey. And that you need to make the most of the journey, to enjoy the journey along the way. So you got some of those that say it's not about the journey but the destination, and others say it's about the destination and not the journey. Well, I've got another point of view I'd like to give to you today. And I would say that when it comes to traveling, it's not necessarily about the destination or the journey. It's about the people who are with you on the journey. Right? I'm just going to be honest with you. I've taken some trips. I've taken some mission trips before with people who about drove me crazy. How many of you know if you take the wrong people with you on the journey, it can make your life miserable? And all you can think about is, if this journey doesn't end pretty quick, I'm either going to take my own life or I'm going to take somebody else's life, right? Now, how many of you know today that we as followers of Christ, we're all on a journey? Our marriages, we're on a journey. Our families, we're on a journey. Our church, we are on a journey. And it's important who is with us on the journey. And notice on this journey, God says, go on to the land. I'm going to send an angel ahead of you. I'm going to drive out all of those paganites. But he says, I will not go with you any further on this journey. Now, God is not saying that I'm removing my omnipresence from you. God just can't do that. That's who God is in his essence and in his nature. He is omnipresent. He is everywhere present all the time. But what he's saying to them here is, I am removing my manifest presence from you. And they had the manifest presence of God with them throughout this journey. They had that pillar of cloud that guided them by day, and they had the pillar of fire that guided them by night. They had visible manifestations of the presence of God. But now God is saying, for the rest of this journey, I'm not going with you. I'm removing my visible manifest presence from you. Now, what was the response of the people? When the people heard these distressing words, they began to mourn. And let me tell you something. We should all mourn. We should all be remorseful. If for one moment we think the presence of God is leaving us and departing us. And they began to mourn, and no one put on any ornaments. We'll talk more about that in just a moment. For the Lord had said to Moses, tell the Israelites, you're a stiff-necked people. And if I were to go with you even for a moment, I might destroy you. And so he goes on in verse 5, the second part of verse 5, and he says, now take off your ornaments, and I'll decide what to do with you. So the Israelites stripped off their ornaments at Mount Horeb, or at Mount Sinai. Now, what are these ornaments that we're talking about here? Well, you remember that the Israelites had been a nation of slaves in Egypt for over 400 years, for 430 years. They had been slaves. When God finally brought them out of Egypt, the Bible said that the Israelites plundered the Egyptians. And they took out of Egypt with them, sort of as payment for all of those years of slavery, they took out of Egypt with them gold and silver and jewelry. As a matter of fact, a lot of the Egyptians were coming to the Israelites and giving them those things. But notice when they get to the bottom of Mount Sinai and they think Moses is not going to show up, what do? They take those ornaments, they take that jewelry that God blessed them with, that God himself gave it to them, and what do? They make an idol out of the blessing of God. Now you listen to me this morning. If you and I are not careful, we can do the very same thing. And instead of money being something that God has provided for us to meet our needs, money can become an idol that we trust in other than God to provide for us. And so he told them to strip off those ornaments. And when they would strip off those ornaments, that was symbolic of them repenting of their sins. See, you and I need to understand this morning that entering God's presence requires repentance. Listen to what the psalmist said in Psalm 24 and 3. He said, who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place, in his presence? He said, I'll tell you who. The one who has clean hands and a pure heart. Look at this. Who does not trust in an idol. Who has not put their trust in an idol rather than the true God, or swear by a false god. This is why God said to the nation of Israel in 2 Chronicles 7:14, he said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and do what? And seek my face. Oh, hallelujah. And then notice what he put there along with seeking his face, and turn from their wicked ways. You see, a part of seeking God is repentance, because you cannot get into the presence of God with an unclean heart, with an impure heart. And he said, seek my face, turn from your wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, then I will forgive your sins, and then I will heal your land. You see, these Israelites had to understand that they just had to leave some things behind. There were some things that they were not going to be able to take with them into the presence of God. And you and I need to understand that as well, that there are some things, anything that has become an idol to you, anything that you trust in more than you trust in the God of heaven, if you want to get into the presence of God, you got to leave all of that behind. You've got to turn away from those things and turn your heart back to God. But notice the story continues in verse 7. Now Moses used to take a tent and pitch it outside the camp some distance away. How many of you know sometimes you just got to get away from everybody else? Especially those folks, those Israelites. And notice what he called the place. He called it the tent of meeting because the tabernacle had not yet been built and constructed. So he had his own little tent of meeting. And anyone inquiring of the Lord would go to the tent of meeting outside the camp. Because if you were to inquire of the Lord, you had to go to the tent and you had to do it through Moses. Moses was the mediator between the people and God. So notice it says, and whenever Moses went out to the tent, all the people rose and stood at the entrances to their tents, watching Moses until he entered his tent. How many of you know some people are content to watch you go into the presence of God, but they have no hunger or desire to get into the presence of God themselves? You go in and then you come back and tell me how it was. But notice the story continues, and Moses went into the tent. The pillar of cloud would come down, which was a visible manifestation of the Shekinah glory of God. And it would come down and stay at the entrance. Now, I just got to throw this in. I didn't throw this in the first service. But can I tell you, there was only one other person who got to go into that tent with Moses. You know who it was? Joshua. The very one who wrote the book that right now our theme comes from, that as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As a matter of fact, the Bible even tells us that when Moses would leave the tent, Joshua would stay there in the presence of the Lord. But notice that Moses went into the tent, the pillar of cloud would come down and stay at the entrance while the Lord spoke with Moses. So notice, the Lord is not speaking to everybody. He's only speaking to Moses, and then Moses relays to the people everything that God has said. And if the people want to inquire of God, they have to go through Moses. What does that tell us? It tells us that accessing God's presence requires a mediator. You say, well, now, Pastor, we're no longer under that old covenant. We're under the new covenant. Who is my mediator? Yeah. First service, some folks were looking at me like I, as your pastor, was your mediator. Can you imagine if that were the case? Let's just say that next Sunday you come in and I've set up a tent out on the front lawn, and I've said I'm going into the tent of meeting and I'm going to inquire of God about some of you. So if you want to know what God has to say about you, then come to the tent of meeting. And I'll tell you. As a matter of fact, if I clap my hands, that means God's good with you and that God's going to bless you. But if I stomp my feet, then that means God's displeased with you and he's about to strike you with leprosy. Some of you are laughing nervously like, that's not really going to happen, is it, Pastor? No, it's not going to happen. You see, what we see with the sacrificial system in the Old Testament is we see an Old Testament concept that becomes a magnificent truth in the New Testament. Under the Old Covenant, you have to understand that the sacrifice that was offered for the sins of the people was insufficient, because the Bible says that the blood of bulls and goats could not take away the sins of the people. Not only that, the high priest was sinful. So you got a sinful high priest and an insufficient sacrifice that just doesn't work. Well, that's only a concept that reveals a magnificent truth in the New Testament. Because in the New Testament, whereas the Old Testament sacrifice was insufficient and the high priest was sinful, in the New Testament, the high priest is without sin and the sacrifice is sufficient. Because both the high priest and the sacrifice is pure, is holy, is clean, is without sin. Oh, listen to what the writer of Hebrews said. He said, under the old covenant, the priest stands and ministers before the altar day after day, offering the same sacrifices again and again, which can never take away sins. It was insufficient. But notice, he says, under the new covenant, our high priest, who is Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, has offered himself. You see, the high priest is the sacrifice. He offered himself to God, look at this, as a single sacrifice. Not every, a single sacrifice for sins. And I love this. It is good for all time. He only had to die one time. And then it said that he sat down in the place of honor at God's right hand. And then I love verse 14. You can't leave out verse 14. By that one offering, he forever, everybody say forever. He forever made you perfect. Yes. That spirit that used to be dead, that has now been quickened by the Spirit of God. In your spirit, you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. In your spirit, you are hidden in Christ Jesus. So that when you walk into the throne room of God, God does not see you. He sees Jesus. Jesus. And notice he said, he made perfect forever those who are being made holy. Yeah, we're still in process in our soul, but in our spirit, oh my goodness, I wish somebody could get a hold of this morning, that God has redeemed and ransomed and saved you, forever made perfect those who are being saved. Paul said it like this in 2 Timothy chapter 2. He said, there's one God and there's one mediator between God and mankind, and it's the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all people. What I'm trying to tell you this morning, Cooper City Church of God, is you have a mediator. You have access into the very presence of God through Christ Jesus. Oh, you ought to get more excited about that. Because apart from him, you and I walk in, that's the end of us. You think I'm going to boldly? I know the Bible says come boldly. But do you think I'm going to come boldly apart from Christ? Knowing the sins of my past? No way, friend. I come before the throne of God through Christ Jesus. He gives me access into the presence of God. But it doesn't stop there. Let's go back to the story, Exodus 33, verse 12. Moses then says to the Lord, Lord, you've been telling me, lead these people, but you've not let me know whom you will send with me. Now, wait a minute, didn't God already tell him, I'm going to have an angel go before you? But Moses is like, no, don't talk to me about no angels. I thank you for the angels, Lord. But I need to know that more than the angels. And notice he goes on in verse 12, the last part of verse 12, he said, you have said, God, you yourself have said to me, I know you by name, and you have found favor with me. So he said, if that be the case, God, if I have found favor with you. Notice what Moses doesn't say. He doesn't say, if I have found favor with you, God, then give me more stuff. Bigger house. Nicer car. More ornaments. No. He said, if I have favor with you, God, teach me your ways, so that I may know you. You see, that's a man with a heart that is seeking the face of God and not the hand of God. That I might continue to find favor with you. And he said, remember something, God, this ain't my people. This nation is your people. And listen to what the Lord does. The Lord replies to him and said, okay, Moses, you want to know who's going with you? I'll tell you who's going with you. He said, my presence will go with you. And I'll give you rest. Nothing for you to worry about, Moses. Nothing for you to fear. Nothing for you to be anxious about. Nothing for you to stress about, Moses. I want you to know I'm going to be with you. And listen to what Moses said. He said, well, okay, God, but let me just tell you this. If your presence doesn't go with us, then do not send us up from here. God, if your presence is not going with us, then please, we're not going to take another step. We're going to stay right where we are. And notice, he said, how is anyone going to know that you are pleased with me and with your people unless you go with us? What else will distinguish me and your people from all the other people on the face of the earth? In other words, Moses is saying, God, the only thing that distinguishes the nation of Israel from all other nations is your presence. That's the only thing that separates us. That's the only thing that sets us apart. And if you take your presence away with us, God, then how are we going to be any different than any other nation? And so the Lord said to Moses, I will do the very thing you have asked because I'm pleased with you and I know you. You've spent time with me, Moses. You've been in my presence. You seek my face. So I don't just have an acquaintance with you. I know you by name. I know you personally. I know you intimately. And notice what Moses said, because remember, God had said, go ahead, Moses, go on to the promised land. I promised that to your forefathers. Go on to the promised land. I'm going to send an angel ahead of you. I'm going to make sure that I drive out all of those pagan idols. You're going to go into this land of blessing that flows with milk and honey. But do you know what Moses said? Moses said, God, I'm grateful that you're going to take us to that land of promise. And I'm grateful, God, that you're going to send an angel ahead of us. But God, I need more than an angel. I need you, God. We need you, God. We need your presence, God. God, I'm thankful for your blessings. And God, I'm thankful for your victory. And God, I'm thankful for your triumph. But God, none of that means anything apart from your presence, God. What we need more than anything else, God, is your presence. And do you know why Moses would say that? Moses would say that because he knows that any success apart from the presence of God is only temporary. It's only success that comes with the active presence of God that is sustainable, that will last. I say all of that to say this, and that is that God's presence is vital. Listen to me this morning, Dad and Mom. God may have blessed you, but listen, if we're not careful, sometimes we get it reversed. Because we just automatically think that if God's blessing us, then his presence must be with us. But the providence of God is not always indicative of the provision of God, or the presence of God, should I say. That the provision of God is not necessarily an indicator that you have the presence of God. I mean, we know people who are not even followers of Christ that we might call blessed, have a lot of money, have a nice home, but it's only temporary success. It's only temporary victory. And Moses knew that. Moses knew. Thank you, God, for all the blessings. Thank you, God, for all that awaits us in the land. But God, if you're not going with us, we're just going to stay right here. Listen to me, we can be blessed. You can be blessed in your marriage. You can be blessed in your home. We can be blessed as a church. But listen to me, there are not enough programs and there's not enough talent that can cover up for a church that is void and empty of the presence of Almighty God. Give me His presence over anything and all things. Hallelujah. And then notice, the story winds up and it says that Moses then looked at God, look at this, and said, "Now Lord, show me your glory. I want to see you in all of your presence. I want to see in all of your essence, God. Show me your glory." And listen to how God answered Moses. "And the Lord said, I will cause my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. And then he said, I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion." Now, think about this, because it almost looks like a disconnect here, doesn't it? That Moses said, "Lord, show me your glory." And then in response, God says, "I'm going to show you my goodness." God, show me your glory. And God says, "I'm going to show you my goodness." But listen, there's not a disconnect at all. Because once you get into the presence of God, the first thing that you're going to discover about God is that God is good. Oh, has He been good to anybody here in this room today? So you and I, we need to know today that there is life. There's life in the presence of God. Do you know what keeps most people from trying to get into the presence of God, seeking the presence of God? It's because they're afraid that once they get into the presence of God, it's not going to be anything but condemnation. That being called into the presence of God is like being called into the principal's office. Anybody ever got called into the principal's office? Oh, I went to the principal's office way, way, way too many times when I was in high school. And every time I went into the principal's office, it was not good. I wasn't going to the principal's office to get rewarded. I was going into the principal's office to be disciplined. And more than once, I heard my principal say to me, "Victor, you're ruining your life. You're never going to add up to anything. There's not a college in this world that will accept you." It was all condemnation. Many years after I graduated high school, my uncle passed away. Donald Wayne, we called him Yogi. And the family called and asked me if I would do his funeral. Guess where they were doing his funeral? Thompson High School, where I graduated. Guess who was sitting on the front row? My principal and my assistant principal. I'm not gonna mind telling you, I had some PTSD. I felt like I was in the principal's office all over again. Because every time I walked in there, it was about condemnation and guilt and shame. And that's the way some of you feel when you're invited into the presence of God. You see, you think that all you're going to find there is condemnation. All you're going to find there is guilt. All you're going to find there is shame. But notice what Moses said. He said, "Lord, show me your glory." And the Lord said, "I'm going to show you my goodness." Because there's goodness in the presence of the Lord. And he said, "I'm going to show compassion to whom I'll show compassion. I'll show mercy to who I'm going to show mercy." There's compassion in the presence of God. There's mercy in the presence of God. Listen to what the psalmist said in Psalm 34. He said, "I sought the Lord and he answered me and delivered me from all my fears." I used to be afraid to go into the presence of God, but now that I've seen who God really is, I'm no longer afraid. He delivered me from all of my fears. And he said that those who look to him, they're radiant. They don't have guilt and shame and discouragement and depression on their face after being in the presence of God. No, they are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. Amos said this in Amos 5 and 4. He said, seek me and what? Live. There's life in the presence of God. The psalmist said it like this in Psalm 16 and 11. You will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Acts chapter 3 verse 19. Repent therefore and be converted, that your sins might be blotted out, so that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. Jude, the brother of Jesus, in verse 24 said, now unto him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. There's goodness in the presence of God. There's compassion in the presence of God. There's mercy in the presence of God. There is life in the presence of God. There is joy in the presence of God. There's refreshing in the presence of God. There's forgiveness in the presence of God. There is healing in the presence of God. There's deliverance in the presence of God. Lord, show us your glory. Show us your glory. Show us your glory.